Hello everyone, my name is Sarah Jansen and I'm a master's student at the University of Amsterdam. I would like to start by thanking the organizers very much for organizing this conference and for giving me the opportunity to talk about our paper, which is called Enumerating All Bilocal Clifford Distillation Protocols Through Symmetry Reduction. You can find it here on the archive. I started working on this project during my bachelor's thesis at Delft University of Technology. Here, I worked closely with Kenneth Goodenough, Sebastian de Boon, Dion Gijsheid, and David Elkoes. So I want to stress that this is joint work by all of us. I will start by giving a quick recap of what entanglement distillation is and by giving some motivation for our work. Then I will explain to you the specific class of protocols that we considered, which are the bilocal Clifford protocols. And then I will move on to the symmetry reduction. This part is split into two topics, namely the distillation subgroup and Werner symmetries. At this point, most of these topics probably do not mean a lot to you, but I will explain it all once we get there. As you probably all know, entanglement is essential for many tasks in quantum communication. However, due to experimental limitations, in practice, entanglement is always noisy. This means that it has a non-unit fidelity to a maximally entangled target state. A lower fidelity can lead to a lower rate at which certain tasks can be performed, or even make tasks impossible. So it is of great importance to increase this fidelity. This can be done using entanglement distillation. The idea of entanglement distillation is that we start with a number of states with a lower fidelity, and then using local operations and classical communication only, we transform this into a smaller number of states with a higher fidelity. A well-known example of such a distillation protocol is the Dames protocol, which was presented by Deutsch et al. In 1996. In this protocol, we start with a two-fold tensor product of a Bell diagonal state. Now, the first step is that Alice and Bob perform local operations on their qubits. In the Dames protocol, these operations consist of phase operations, Hadamard operations, and CNOT operations. The next step is that Alice and Bob measure one of their qubits in the computational basis. They communicate the outcomes via classical communication and check for pairwise correlation. If both outcomes are the same, they keep the state that was not measured and they call the protocol successful. If the outcomes are not equal, then they discard all states and the protocol was unsuccessful. The Dames protocol is an instance of a 2-to-1 distillation protocol because we start with two states in the input and we are left with one in the output. Now to increase the fidelity even further, we can concatenate the Dames protocol. For instance, we can apply the Dames protocol twice to different input states and then use the two output states in another round of the Dames protocol. This procedure is known as nested entanglement pumping, and it was studied by Durr and Briegel. Now suppose that we want to find good distillation protocols. In particular, we are looking for protocols that are experimentally friendly. That is, we consider protocols that use only a small number of states in the input and require only a single round of communication between Alice and Bob. A priori, any valid unitary operation on Alice or Bob's side could give a good protocol. So how do we explore the space of protocols and find the optimal ones for a desired metric? Well, in previous papers, various approaches have been used to find good distillation protocols. For instance, Krasanov et al. Used genetic algorithms to find good distillation protocols in the presence of noise and finite resources. Another approach was used by Rosbedek et al., who used the so-called CSAL method. In this method, we start with an initial protocol, and then we first optimize Alice's operation, and then keeping this operation fixed, we optimize Bob's operation. Finally, Zhao et al. Presented the LOCC net, which is a machine learning framework that can be used to find good distillation protocols. Complementary to these previous works, we present a more systematic procedure to find good distillation protocols. To be able to do this, we restrict ourselves from the big space of all distillation protocols to a smaller but relevant subset of protocols and states. We build upon the work from De Haene et al. We'll consider the same protocols and states and presented a relatively good performing 4-to-1 protocol. Let me explain to you which protocols and which states we consider. So we consider a system that consists of two parties, Alice and Bob, who share a tensor product of n Bell diagonal states. Recall that a Bell diagonal state is a state that can be written in the following form, where these are the four Bell states and the p's form a probability distribution. And the first step in the protocol is that Alice and Bob perform a so-called bilocal Clifford operation. What does this mean? Well, Clifford operations are the group of operations that are generated by Hadamard operations, phased operations, and CMULT operations on any of the qubits. So we can write any Clifford operation in terms of these three types of operations. Bilocal here means that if Alice performs a certain Clifford operation, then Bob performs the entry-wise conjugate of this operation. In terms of a circuit, this step looks something like this. Now, for reasons that will become clear shortly, I write here C transpose instead of just C, and Bob's operation then becomes the conjugate transpose. Let us look at the effect of these Clifford operations in a bit more detail. For this, first note that we can write any of the four Bell states in terms of the 5 plus state conjugated with one of the Pauli matrices on Bob's side. As a result, we can rewrite our tensor product of Bell diagonal states as the n-fold tensor product of the 5 plus state with some additional channel. And here this channel and p applies with a probability small p a certain Pauli string to our initial state. So in the form of a circuit, we go from the top one to the bottom one, where we have the n-fold tensor product of the 5 plus state with an additional channel. For the next step in our analysis, we use the following inequality, which basically says that we can pull any operation from Alice's side to Bob's side or vice versa by taking the transpose. This equality can easily be verified using some linear algebra. Now we use this equality to get rid of this weird looking transpose, and instead we write it as a conjugation on Bob's side. Now you may wonder, why did we do all this? Why is this useful? Well, it is a well-known fact that if we conjugate Pauli strings, so tensor products of Pauli matrices, with Clifford operations, then this results in a permutation of the Pauli strings. Another way to look at this is that a conjugation with Clifford operations results in a permutation of the probabilities that describe our system. So we conclude that a bilocal Clifford operation permutes the probabilities that describe our system. And we indicated this as follows. So we start with a system that is described by these probabilities, and we permute this to get the new probabilities, which we indicate with the wiggle on the p. And in the form of a circuit, this now simply looks like this. Let me illustrate this for a scenario where we start with two Bell diagonal states. Each of these states is described by four probabilities, so that their joint state is described by 16 probabilities. Now, we can apply a bilocal Clifford operation on this initial state, and this results in a permutation of the probabilities. So for instance, we can apply a phase operation on the second qubit, and this results in swapping the two columns in the middle. And finally, I should note that not all permutations are induced by bilocal Clifford operations. So we cannot just pick any two coefficients and swap them. That's enough about bilocal Clifford operations for now. let me move on to the next step of the protocol. So this is what we had so far. We started with a tensor product of n bal diagonal states, and we applied a bilocal Clifford operation. Next, similarly to the Thames protocol, Alice and Bob measure out all but one of their qubits in the computational basis. They communicate the outcomes via classical communication, and they check for pairwise correlation. If all outcomes are pairwise equal, so like this for instance, they call the protocol successful and they keep the state that was not measured. If the outcomes are not all pairwise equal, so for instance if Bob measures a 0 here instead of a 1, then the protocol was unsuccessful and they discard all states. What does this look like in the scenario where n equals 2? Well, recall that we could describe the scenario with 16 probabilities. Now we perform a measurement on the second qubit pair, and we want the outcomes to be equal. This is the case if the second qubit pair is either in the 5 plus or in the 5 minus state, so either in the I or in the C column. We see that the probability of a successful protocol is equal to the sum of the probabilities in these gray columns. Now we want our remaining qubit pair to have a high fidelity to maximally entangled target state, which in our case is the 5 plus state. This fidelity is given by the sum of these two encircled elements divided by the success probability. The elements in gray play a very important role for us, so we give them a name. For reasons that you maybe can imagine by looking at this picture, we call the gray columns the pillars, and these elements in the lower corners the base. The nice thing about this geometric picture is that it easily generalizes to larger input states. For instance, if we start with 3 states, then we can put the probabilities in a cube, and the pillars are given by these 4 columns. And the base is given by these 4 elements in the lower corners. Now for larger values of n, we get some sort of hypercube, which I cannot draw, but hopefully you get the idea. Before moving on to the next topic, let me quickly recap what we've done so far. So we consider bilocal Clifford operations, and we've seen that they result in a permutation of the probabilities. Now, in order to find good protocols, we want to find the operations or the permutations that give good values of the success probability and the fidelity. We've also seen that not all permutations are possible, so we cannot just pick the best coefficients and put them at the right place. Instead, we could check all bilocal Clifford operations, but the number of Clifford operations grows really fast. For instance, for n is 8, there are about 6 times 10 to the 40 protocols, so checking them all becomes simply infeasible. In our work, we limit the number of cases to check by taking into account the symmetries of the input states and the protocols. The remainder of this talk will be devoted to explaining this to you in more detail. We will first have a look at the scenario where we start with a general input state, so with no further assumptions about the symmetry. And then we will have a look at the highly symmetric case of the n-fold tensor product of a Wirner state. Okay, so we start by considering a general input state, which is a tensor product of n arbitrary bal diagonal states. For simplicity, I will explain everything for the scenario where n equals 2, but everything that I will tell you also holds for larger values of n. By looking at this picture, you can maybe imagine that there are some operations that do not change the fidelity and the success probability. For instance, we can apply a Hadamard operation on the first qubit, and this results in swapping these two rows. As a result, some of the elements in the pillars are permuted, but the total set of elements in the pillars stays the same. So the success probability does not change. Moreover, the base is not affected at all, so the fidelity also stays the same. Now suppose that we consider an arbitrary bilocal Clifford operation. This operation results in a certain fidelity and a certain success probability. Now, after we have performed this operation, we can perform another operation. And if this operation C prime does not change the fidelity and success probability anymore, we see that these two circuits give the same fidelity and success probability. In general, we see that C and C prime C, which means first applying C and then applying C prime, give the same fidelity and success probability, even only if C prime does not change these two anymore. And this is the case even only if C prime permutes the elements of the pillars among themselves and the elements of the base among themselves. The bilocal Clifford operations C prime that satisfy these constraints form a subgroup of the Clifford group, which we call the distillation subgroup. We now know that any two bilocal Clifford operations, C1 and C2, give the same fidelity and success probability if and only if C2 is equal to first applying C1 and then applying C prime, where C prime is in our distillation subgroup. As a result, we can divide our big space of all Clifford operations into smaller sets, where all elements in the same set give the same fidelity and success probability. Now, when we are looking for the best protocols, it is sufficient to consider only one element of each set, because all elements in the same set give the same results. How much do we gain from this? To see that, we use a famous result from mathematics, which is known as Lagrange's theorem. This theorem states that all these sets have the same size and that the number of sets is equal to the number of elements in the Clifford group divided by the number of elements in the distillation subgroup. In mathematics, this number is called the index and the sets are called cosets. Now, a procedure to find all distillation protocols is as follows. We start by randomly sampling bilocal Clifford operations. Each time we have sampled an operation, we check if the coset that it belongs to is already represented. We can do this by checking which elements are mapped to the base and which elements are mapped to the pillars. Because by definition, two Clifford operations that are in the same coset map the same elements to the base and the same elements to the pillars. If the coset is not represented yet, we add our bilocal Clifford operation to a big set of operations. And we continue this procedure until we have found index many protocols. The expected running time of this procedure is of order index log index. Okay, this sounds like a plan, but there is one problem left to tackle. We need to know the index. And we know that the index is defined as the order of the Clifford group divided by the order of the distillation subgroup. And the order of the Clifford group is well known, but the distillation subgroup is new, so we need to determine its order. In our paper, we proved that the distillation subgroup is generated by a Hadamard operation on the first qubit, phase operations on any qubit, and C0 operations on all qubits except, all C0 operations except the ones that have the first qubit as control qubit. The proof of this lemma is rather technical, so I won't go into it now, but you can find it in our paper or ask me about afterwards. Using this lemma, we are able to find the order of the distillation subgroup, and thereby we found the index, which made us really happy. Now in this table, you can see how much we gained from it. In the top row, you see the number of states in the input. Then you see the number of elements in the Clifford group, which is the number of cases that we needed to check originally. Then in the last row, you see the index, which is the number of cases that we need to check now. And as you can see, this number is a lot smaller than what we had before. Up to NS5, we are able to find all distillation protocols, and thus we can now pick and choose the protocol that optimizes any figure of merit for any input state. Unfortunately, for larger values of n, this procedure becomes infeasible because there are still too many cases left to check and to store. What can we do to go further? Well, up to this point, we haven't made any assumptions about our input state, other than that it is a tensor product of Bell diagonal states. But you can maybe imagine that if the input state possesses some sort of symmetry, so if there are some coefficients that are equal, then there are more protocols that give the same results. I will illustrate this by looking at the n-fold tensor product of a Wöhner state. A Wöhner state is a Bell diagonal state with three equal coefficients. So we see that this input state has a lot of symmetry. All Bell diagonal states are equal, and each of the Bell diagonal states has three equal coefficients. We exploit these symmetries to limit our search phase even further. Firstly, of course, we can still add or remove elements from the distillation subgroup at the end of our protocol, and that won't change the fidelity and the success probability. But now, since all Bell diagonal states are equal, we can also swap any two Bell diagonal states at the beginning of our protocol, and this won't change the result. Moreover, we can permute the equal coefficients. We can do this by applying a Hadamard operation, which permutes the second and the fourth coefficient, and by applying phase operations, which permutes the second and the third coefficient. So we see that these two protocols, although they look very differently, actually give the same fidelity and success probability. In general, we see that two bilocal Clifford operations, C1 and C2, give the same success probability and fidelity, even only if C2 is equal to first applying C double prime, then applying C1, and then applying C prime, where C prime is in the distillation subgroup as before, and C double prime is in this new subgroup Kn, where Kn is a subgroup that is generated by Hadamard operations, phase operations, and swap operations on any of the qubits. So this is the subgroup that arises from the symmetry in our input state. As a result, we can now again divide our big space of Clifford operations into smaller sets. But this time the sets are larger because there are more sets, more operations that give the same results. And thus there are fewer cases that we need to check. How much did we gain from this? Well, to see that, I extended the table that we had before. So here you can see the number of Clifford operations. Then you can see the index, which was the number of cases that we needed to check when we only took into account the distillation subgroup. And finally, in the last row, we have the number of cases that we need to check now. And as you can see, this number is a lot smaller than what we had before. So up to NS8 Wöhner states, we were able to find all distillation protocols. Did we find any good protocols? Well, good depends of course on your measure, but I think we definitely found some good performing protocols. To illustrate this, let me show you one of our results. In this figure, you can see the increase in fidelity between the input states and the output. The dotted lines correspond to the Dimps protocol and concatenation thereof. The solid lines correspond to the protocols that we found that achieved the highest fidelity. So we see that for NS2 and NS3, the results are equal, but for larger values of n, our protocols achieve a higher fidelity than the Dimps protocols. Moreover, the circuits that we found have a comparable depth and number of 2-qubit operations as previously known protocols. For instance, for NS4, we found the following protocol that achieved the highest fidelity. So this protocol should be applied on both Alice and Bob's side. And we see that it consists of 4 two-qubit operations, namely 1 C0 operation and 3 CZ operations, and that it has depth 3. For other values of n, we have included circuits in our paper. Now, this observation indicates that protocols that we found are experimentally feasible. Of course, this is just one figure of merit, and in our paper we have included a more in-depth comparison between previously known protocols and our new protocols. So to summarize, we have looked at bilocal Clifford protocols, which are distillation protocols that consist of local operations with some additional constraints, measurements in a computational basis, and a single route of classical communication. By taking into account the symmetries of the protocols in the input states, we were able to find all protocols up to NS5 for general bidiagonal states and up to NS8 for n-fold tensor products of a Wörner state. We can now just pick and choose the protocol that optimizes any figure of merit for any input state. And by doing so, we have found some protocols that strongly improved upon previously known protocols. Regarding future work, there are some assumptions that could be weakened. In this paper, we've only looked at the scenario where we measure all but one of the qubits, but we could also measure fewer qubits and we are left with more qubits. We have already generalized theoretical results to this scenario, but there appear to be some nice mathematical structures hidden here that can be investigated further. Another assumption that can be weakened is the success condition. We now choose to define a protocol as successful. If all outcomes are pairwise equal, but other success conditions are also possible and might lead to better distillation protocols. And with that in mind, I would like to conclude this presentation and thank you all very much for your attention.